نستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدى محمد صلوات الله وسلامه عليه، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل دلالة في النار. وبعد، before we begin this brief khutbah inshallah on the subject of which we promised two or three weeks ago that we would continue talking about the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een, and we promise and we hope bimashiyatillah, it is the will of Allah, that we will do 1 week a male companion, the next week a female companion, and try to interweave within those companions some companions who are the youth. But before we begin, inshallah, we'd just like to explain to some of the people who may not understand that for Jum'ah, it is a part of the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his Sahaba, and they used to practice this when he was in their midst. The Adhan being called before the time the sun declines from his zenith. Some of you may be wondering, why are they calling the Adhan and beginning the khutbah before the time the Salah comes in? This is from the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And in some Muslim countries, alhamdulillah, you can find this being done. Around 11:30 or 12 o'clock, before the time actually comes in, you'll hear the Adhan on Jum'ah. So for those who are amazed on us beginning at this time, this is the reason. And inshallah, next week we'll begin at 1 o'clock, inshallah ta'ala. Of the many stories, among the stories of the Sahaba, we find the story of a young man, a companion of the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam. And this young man grew up in a household that had the aroma sweeter than the aroma of the Oud Bukhur that you smell right now. This aroma was the aroma of Iman. Tuyubul Iman. This is the house that this young man grew up in. And he was a very young man in Islam. Maybe about 10 years old. And in that city that he lived, at that time it was called Yathrib, which is now called Al-Madinah, the city of our beloved Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He and his father and his mother and his maternal aunt and his brothers, they accepted Islam in the very early days of Islam in Al-Madinah. And they had the opportunity, after their acceptance of Islam, to go to the city that used to be called Bakkah, as Allah mentions it in the Quran, Bakkah, and is now known as the city of Mecca. And for those who want to know what Bakkah means, Bakkah comes from the word which means to break the neck of the tyrants. To break the necks of the tyrants. They were blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to leave Yathrib and go to Mecca to give the pledge, the bay'ah, al-aqabah, to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima mazida. So he and his mother and his father, whose name was Zayd ibn Asim ibn Amr al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, and his mother, inshallah, who we'll be talking about in the next khutbah, whose name was Nusaybah bint Ka'b radiallahu anha, the first woman to pick up a sword in Islam. They and 70 other people went to make the bay'ah with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the men putting their hands in the Messenger of Allah's blessed hand, and the women making the pledge with their mouths, along with the men with their mouths. Because we know that it is haram for a man to shake the hand of a woman that is not halal for him. So they went to Mecca, and in the deep darkness of the night, those individuals whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين تبعوهم بإحسان رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه. Those first individuals from among the Muhajirun and the Ansar and those who follow them with Ihsan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He is pleased with them and they are pleased with them. With Him. They took their hands, the men of this ummah, and the hand of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and made the bay'ah. And this young man who grew up in this household of Iman, he reached out with his tender hand, maybe 9 or 10 or maybe younger, and put his hand in that moonlit night into the hand of the greatest of people that ever walked the face of the planet Earth, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This young man's name was Habib ibn Zayd ibn Asim ibn Amr al-Ansari radiyallahu anhu. But then, as all Muslims, Zayd was going to be tested by his Lord, Rabbul Alameen. And the test for the Muslim is always a good one. No matter what happens to the believer, it's always good for him. It's amazing, the affairs of the believer. As the Prophet ﷺ told us in one hadith, that inshaAllah ta'ala has an authentic chain, he said, Al-Masa'ibu wal-Amradu wal-Ahzanu fi dunya jaza'. That calamities and sicknesses and anxieties and sadness and sorrow is a reward for the believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was going to test Zayd, or I should say Habib ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu, with a tremendous test. In the 9th year of the Hijrah, people started coming to Islam in groves, in droves, in large groups from all of the Arabian Peninsula. And people started coming not only in groves and troops, leaders were accepting Islam and bringing their tribes with them. Whole tribes and families were standing in front of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, converging on Mecca to say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. And one of those individuals who came from the highlands of Najd, he brought his tribe with him from the people of Banu Hanifa. His name was Musaylima ibn Habib. He came and announced his Islam in the presence of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He announced his Islam and his tribe announced their Islam. And then the Messenger of Allah, the most gracious of hosts, no host is better than the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He presented all the individuals of all the tribes and their leaders with gifts for their acceptance of Islam. And we know that we can do this to encourage someone to accept Islam. You can give them food, you can give them money, whatever, to encourage them to accept Islam. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the best of du'at. He was the best of the people who invite to La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But unfortunately, as we mentioned in at least 2 khutbahs ago, this Musaylima, this eager, zealous, self-aggrandizing individual, went back to the highlands of Najd and apostated. Left Islam, renounced and denounced the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-Islam. Not only did he renounce and denounce Islam, many of the people, if not all the people in his tribe, also renounced Islam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increased the kufr in his heart, and increased the shirk of it in his heart, and increased the anad, the obstinance in his heart. And he had the unmitigated gall, the audacity, to not only leave Islam, but to say while the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, was still alive in the same country, in the same peninsula, أنا رسول الله مثلكم. I'm the messenger of Allah, I'm the prophet of Allah just like you. And he sent a letter to the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And those people who were with him supported him. So much so that one individual said, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan lasadiqun. Wa anna al-musaylima lakazzab. I recognize that Muhammad is truthful, one of the people of Banu Hanifa, and I recognize the people who were the people who were with Musaylima. I recognize that this al-kazzab, this Musaylima, this imposter is a liar. وَلَكِنَّ الْكَذَّابَ رَبِيعَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ صَادِقِ مُدَرْ. He said, but because of the asabiyah in his chest, the party spirit in his chest, the nationalism in his chest, the people who today have the same nationalism, if not worse, but because Rabi'a, which was the people connected to Banu Hanifa, their tribe, he said was more dear to me than the truthful one, who comes from Mudar, which is the tribe of the Messenger of Allah connected to Quraysh, I'm going to stick with Musaylimah. He knew that Musaylimah was a liar and an imposter, and bore witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the truthful one. But because of asabiyah, because of qawmiyah, because of tribalism, because of I'm black, I'm white, I'm Arab, I'm Pakistani, I'm whatever, I'm going to stick with Musaylimah. You see the danger of this asabiyah, brothers and sisters in Islam? You see the dangers of sticking to this ethnic, so-called ethnic, cultural, Afrocentric, Arab-centric ideas and philosophies? So, Musaylima, he sent a letter to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, من مسيلمة رسول الله إلى محمد رسول الله أما بعد فإني قد أشركت في الأمر معك وَإِنَّ لَنَا نِصَّ الْأَرْضِ وَلِقُرَيْشٍ نِصَّ الْأَرْضِ وَلَكِنَّ قُرَيْشًا قَوْمٌ يَعْتَدُونَ. He said, from Musaylima, the Messenger of Allah, to Muhammad, the Messenger of Allah, as to what follows, I am ready to participate with you, to be a partner with you in this affair of Islam. In other words, I'm a prophet and you're a prophet. You take that region of Saudi of Arabia, and I'll take this region of Arabia. And one foolish woman who came with him, according to some stories in Sirah, named Saja'a, she wanted to marry him, and she called herself a prophetess, a Nabiya. And her dowry that she requested from him was that they remove Salatul Fajr and Salatul Isha. You, Muhammad, you stay there in the south, and I'll stay in the north. I'll stay in the highlands and you stay down there. We're sharing this nubuwwah. I'm ready to participate with you in this nubuwwah, this prophethood. He says, you take that part of the land and I'll take this part of the land. But the Quraysh are very aggressive people. This is a letter that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received from Musaylima that he sent by two of his followers. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when those individuals came to him, he said, مَا تَقُولَانِ أَنْتُمَا. What do you say? Referring to the letter. They said, نَقُولُ كَمَا قَالُ. We say what he said. Whatever the letter says, that's what we say. We agree with it. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he said to them, أَمَا وَاللَّهِ لَوْلَا أَنَّ الرُّسُلَ لَا تُقْتَلْ. I swear by Allah, if it were not for the fact that messengers cannot be killed, لَضَرَبْتُ أَعْنَاقَكُمَا, I would cut off your heads. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, رضي الله عنه ورضاه, later on after the Prophet died, صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم, he found those individuals who brought that letter, and he told them to make repentance. One of the companions saw them in the souq, in the marketplace, and he approached them. And one of them repented, and the other one whose name was Ibn Nawaha, he told him to repent. And he said, I remember the day that the Messenger of Allah said, if it were not that you are a messenger, meaning any type of messenger who brings a letter, they can't be killed according to the Sharia and according to this hadith. If it were not that you are a messenger, I would kill you. But then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said to him, فَالْيَوْمْ أَنْتَ لَسْتَ بِرَسُولٍ. But today, you're not a messenger. So he told Qarza ibn Ka'b, رضي الله عنه, cut off his head.
and he cut off his hair right there in the souk, and whoever wants to see it, he said, come and let him look at it. This is Islam, brothers. This is this Islam that we came into. The deen of courage, the deen of power, the deen of strength, and the deen of justice. So when the letter got to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wrote a letter to Musaylimah al-Kazzab, the imposter, the liar, the one who claimed prophethood. And this is the way we should look at anyone who comes after Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who claimed messengership or prophethood. We should look at them the way we look at Musaylimah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Min Muhammad Rasul Allah ila Musaylimah al-Kazzab. In the name of Allah, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. From Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Musaylimah al-Kazzab. From Muhammad, the Messenger of Allah, to Musaylimah al-Kazzab. As-salamu ala man ittaba' al-huda. May the greetings be on anyone who follows the right way and the right guidance. Amma ba'd, fa inna al-ardha lillahi yurithuha man yasha'u min 'ibadihi wal 'aqibatu lil muttaqin. Allah will bequeath the earth to whomever of his slaves he wants, and the final triumphant will be for those who have a taqwa. This is a letter that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent to Musaylimah, or wrote to Musaylimah. But he needed someone who had courage, who had strength, who had the sweetness of Iman in his chest to take this letter. And he chose Habib ibn Zayd, a young boy, to take this letter to Musaylimah al-Kazzab. So Habib radiallahu anhu, a very young man, in the prime of his youth, he took this letter from the Messenger of Allah with zeal and eager to Musaylimah al-Kazzab. And when he reached him and Musaylimah saw the letter, he became so furious, so angry, his face turned colors, and the fear of the people in his court became so heightened, some people couldn't even look at his face. He took Habib radiallahu anhu and put him in chains, and waited until the next day, and got all his tawarit, all his taghuts that were with him and supported him, and all the people, the common people who followed him from Banu Hanifa, collected them together to see what he was going to do to Habib radiallahu anhu. Can you imagine this, brothers and sisters? Can you imagine being by yourself in some desolate land out in the forest somewhere, or in some warehouse with the Ku Klux Klan, with the neo-Nazi party, with some Hell's Angels bikers, with the JDL, Jewish Defense League, with some skinheads, all gathered together, were you there, and them testing you if you're Iman? Can you imagine that by yourself chained up? Multiply that by this young boy, Habib ibn Zayd, radiallahu anhu, standing in front of Musaylimah al-Kazzab, the false prophet. So, Musaylimah, he asked him a question. Atashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah? Do you bear witness that Muhammad is the Messenger of Allah? And he said, Naam. He said, Atashhadu anni Rasulullah? Do you bear witness that I am also the Messenger of Allah? And Habib radiallahu anhu said to him, Inna fi udhunayyi samamam an sama'i ma taqood. My ears are deaf to what you just said. Whatever you claim, my ears are blocked out, but whatever you said is blocked out. Deaf. I don't hear anything you're saying. See the Iman in his chest? You see the Iman in this little boy? A child in Islam. He became furious. He ordered the Jalad, the whipper, the executor, to cut off his limb. This is what he told him to do. Cut off his limb. This Jalad, this executor, took this sword, raised it up high, and cut off his right arm completely off until it fell on the ground. Then he asked him again, Atashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah? Do you bear witness that Muhammad is the Messenger of Allah? He said, Nah. Yes. He said, Atashhadu anni Rasulullah? Do you bear witness that I am the Messenger of Allah? And then he said, My ears are blocked. Can you hear what I said? My ears are blocked from what you just said. I don't want to hear what you have to say. They're blocked. They're deaf from hearing what you have to say. والحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. وبعد. So, Musaylimah in his rage, after he saw that this young man was not going to give up his iman, was not going to allow the obedience to the created things come into his heart, a heart that was filled with the fear of only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the desire to see the face of Allah and the garden of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He ordered the jallad once more, cut off his limb. اقطع قطعة من جسده. And this is exactly what he did. He raised the sword again and chopped off his other limb until it rolled over to the first limb that he cut off. And then it became too unbearable for this young boy in Islam, Habib ibn Zayd. And he asked him one more time. And the only thing that he kept saying on his little lips was the name of the man that he took the bay'ah with in Al-Aqaba. Muhammad Rasulullah, Muhammad Rasulullah, Muhammad Rasulullah, Muhammad Rasulullah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the story of Habib ibn Zayd is a story that we need to reflect on every day of our lives if we can. This is a story that shows us that the test that Allah is taking us through is small. These things that we're being afflicted with, these trials, these tribulations, these calamities, the diseases, the loss of a job, the loss of eyesight, the loss of a limb, is nothing in comparison to those individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them, after saying that He is pleased with them and they are pleased with Him, وَأَعَدَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجَرِي تَحْتَهَا الْأَنْهَارِ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. Allah promised them the Jannah, of which rivers flow beneath, and they shall dwell in it forever and ever and ever, and that is the most supreme of triumphants and successes. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the iman of Habib ibn Zayd. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us like those individuals, as-sabiqun al-awwalun, those individuals who preceded us, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with, and they were pleased with Allah azza wa jalla.